have been fallen like the gentle dew. And so it is in the gospel this morning, when we consider the facts of someone caught in their own intrigue, and then suddenly finds that what they thought was going to be their death became the moment of mercy. Let us prepare ourselves for this morning's worship. God, our provider, help us.
It is hard to believe that there is enough to share.
We question
your ways to make different from the ways of the world in which we live.
We turn to
our own understanding rather than trusting in you.
We give
thanks at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life.
Beloved people of God, in Jesus the manna from heaven you are fed and nourished. By Jesus the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven, and you are loved into abundant life.
Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God,
and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Of God's pasture.
We are God's.
any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
So it is written that without a vision, the people perish. Without something in front of them to give them hope, a reason to live, or as the saying goes, we become fully human when we have something to do, someone to love, and something to hope for. I usually go by the lectionary, but I didn't this for the first time in my whole life. I decided I wanted to choose what scripture I wanted to choose. And there's nothing you can do about it because I'm out of here. But to start with the prophet. Micah, whose words are also inscribed over the soffit before you walk into this church. Do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. But he brings forth in this section a vision, a one that is almost too good to be true. What is it like when the day of the Lord comes? He shall judge between many peoples, arbitrate between strong nations far away. And then they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall all sit under their own vines and under their own trees, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. But the history, at least the written history that we have, makes fun of these type of words. It's almost as if this is a dream that cannot possibly come true. So every Sunday when we do the prayers of the faithful, somewhere in those prayers are prayers for peace. And all of you and I have been around long enough to know that at least in our lifetimes there has not been peace. It seems to rise. Various peace treaties are done only to be broken. And we say to ourselves, Micah, your vision is too far above. We cannot hold it to ourselves anymore. And yet, it's the job of the prophets to put forth these visions because, as the saying goes, without hope, the people perish. And so churches like ours go on, and we keep praying for peace despite what we see out there, despite what is in front of our face. And I think the rationale for doing that is because that is the idea of God, that there is peace, that it will happen, maybe not in our time, but sooner or later, something is going to take up humanity, and it will be caught up in this vision of hope when all of humanity will not be disappointed. In the gospel, in this scene, there is one of the most intense scenes, I think, in any of the gospel writings. Notice it's early morning and Jesus is out to spread the word. And where does he do it? In the temple. And all the people come to him, and what does he do? He sits down with them. Our vision is always of Jesus standing and teaching, but he's sitting down with them, putting himself at the level of their own humanity. Not as one is always above them, but in agreement to come to them as let's talk. Let's talk together. Let's see what the hope of God could always be about. And right in the midst of that, the enemies enter in, as they always do, and you can see that in all the four Gospels. What has happened? Well, scribes and Pharisees, hoping to trap Jesus because they see him as one who is breaking the law, as one who could cause an insurrection, as one who goes against all of the teachings, so it seems, and you can read them over and over again in the Gospels, and he's a troublemaker. And if there's one thing that the scribes, the Pharisees, and the chief priests don't want, is a troublemaker as they move closer and closer to the holy days in the temple. But here's what they do. They're arming themselves with the law, and they actually have a person
It says, teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now, the law Moses commanded to us, we should stone her. Now, what do you say? Imagine a law that is so cruel that it takes a person and it surrounds itself with people who pick up the heaviest rocks they can and hurl it toward your body. Notice that scribes and Pharisees belong to a patristic society. No one ever asks if she is caught in adultery. What happened to her partner? She is a woman is brought forth to be shamed. And Jesus hears it. And so what he does is he stoops down and he starts writing on the dust. And his accusers are wondering, what on earth is going on? And he won't say anything. And they kept badgering him. Well, what do you say? What do you say? And it's only then that he arises and he looks at them and says, let him who is without sin cast the first stone. And the very law that they were going to use to kill her is turned back upon them, accusing them of who they really are, but would never admit to anyone else. And so it says, at that moment, all of a sudden, one by one, beginning with the elders, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. And he straightened himself up and said to her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And she says, no, sir. Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Now go your way, and from now on, do not sin again. End of story. Without us knowing what her life would be after that encounter with Jesus, what is it like to encounter the wrath of the law, where everybody surrounds you, determined to kill you, and then suddenly an advocate comes for you, and suddenly, like Shakespeare says, that quality of mercy that is not strained falls like a gentle dew upon herself, and suddenly she goes from death to the possibility of life. Every church, no matter what its denomination, is called to tell a story, one that embodies the very hope of these stories that we're hearing this morning. The Old Testament one that seems so impossible for it to even happen. Right into this gospel story out of John that simply says, mercy is a surprise thing. So it is. Do justice. Love mercy. While you do that, you will walk humbly with your God. And that is what every church is called to do. And it's not always an easy thing because we have our own judgments. Sometimes, like Pharisees and scribes, we have decided what is proper justice. But oftentimes, in our anger, we forget that there's another part that goes with it that says love mercy. If any church is going to preach the gospel, it has to have those things together. Justice without mercy will usually yield to unbridled hate. But you just can't have mercy alone because justice has to be served. And this is why we proclaim that if justice is going to be served, it's found in the very story of Jesus, unjustly condemned to death, unjustly called us insurrectionists. Today marks in the church a transition point in which you are all part of that transition. And it's a wonderful thing, you see, because one of the things that both Joshua and I have been exposed to is what we might call seminary training. And in that training, at least it was made for me, and I'm sure it was for Josh, is the desire to put everything you hear into one point of reference. And I think that point of reference, at least for me, has been a saying that was given to me by my professor of systematic theology, Robert Jensen. And somebody asked him, Jensen, invited us to know Jensen, describe Jesus And he thought for a moment and it floated up. He said, there has lived a man, holy, completely for others, all the way to death. And because of that living that he did, God raised him from the dead so that that spirit that he gave to other people would go on forever into infinity, for all time, for all places, for all churches, for the world itself. And that somehow the final conclusion of all the hopes and the dreams of humanity will be caught up in his self-giving. And so for that, the second reading makes sense. It is in that spirit of self-giving that Paul would write, if there's any encouragement in Christ and consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love. Bring in full accord of one mind. Don't do anything selfish, ambitious, or out of conceit. But in humility, regard others as even better than yourselves. Let each one of you look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. So no matter who is called to be pastor of this church, the whole idea is, A, we're called and trained to bring this very message to every generation. And generations will rise and pass in this church called St. Luke. Pastors will come and go. There will be different ones at different points and eras. But it is the community that grabs hold this idea that ultimately love is going to win. And when that is in one's mind, Shakespeare was right. The quality of mercy is never strained. It rather falls like gentle dew upon the people who know who they are in the crucified and risen Jesus, who has nothing but life in front of him to give to all time and all creation. And may St. Luke be blessed with this vision that does not cause us to die, but gives us hope in the future that somehow God is on your side. He brings you forth to do those things that we call in this church over and over, God's work.
Let us now confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in
God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day,
especially
Rise Against Hunger. And our motto for Rise Against Hunger is, let's give it our big shot, our best shot. Why? During Lent, most of us weren't here. There was no gathering, and we thought, how could we do something, especially for the people in our community? And so we started something, and it was pretty much, we didn't see any of you, but we either suggested you dropping by the office. We did start some services and bring it to service, or mail it. I personally have a real hard time mailing anything, but it worked. And because of that, we had a fund, we were trying for 1,230. And we finally had FEMOR. We sent them $4,615 and over $500 in food. And that was great. Whether you have enough food. But also, we have God's Work Our Hand, which we usually did in September. And that's where we did over 20,000 meals. And it took us all summer to get the money to pay for the meals, to be able to send them. During the pandemic, Rise Against Hunger was not able to have any type of thing where they could make the meals. So for a year and a half, all of those people in other parts of the world did not have that sustenance. And when you think about how we did, I love curbside. But in other parts of the world, they don't have curbside.
They don't have curb.
And also they don't have the money to pay for curbside. So Marty and I were trying to talk about it, and we thought, there's no goal. We don't know what the goal is. But we thought, well, let's give it a shot. And that's what it is. This is our challenge. Let's give it a shot. Let's give it our big shot. Now, in thinking about this, I was thinking about, especially with the Olympics, a lot of sports. So if you were golfing and you put your tee down, somebody might say, give it your best shot. Others would say, just give it a shot, Judy. If you were playing tennis, you know, you take it and you just lob it. Everybody would duck when I'm around. Also, one of the things that I know everybody here does is football. So, a lot of people would say, give it your best shot. Bob said, you're not going to lob that thing in church, are you? So, what I'm going to do is just take this over, because this is our football for God's World, Our Hand. And I'm taking it over to our leader. Okay, I did okay. Okay, let's have a good afternoon. And so we're going on, and so I'm going to let you go ahead and finish up.
Well. Thank you.
think about the others who it is not. And if you can please help with any kind of donation. And then on September 11th, and you all know what September 11th is, but it is also going to be the day that we are making meals. So we need to have you sign up between, it's going to be 9 to 11 on the 11th on Saturday. So thank you all.
August 6th, Friday night, 6:30, Malice in the Palace. Up here,
It's going to be great. And see, Marlis, if you can help with time, talent, or treasure, we didn't go after our grants this year, but Thrivent has been a great corporate sponsor. But anyway, so Judy, I'm sorry to cut into a little bit of your fundraising, but we got to feed the kids, right?
Yeah.
Are you hungry? It's too nice. Table donating the most gets to go first. See, we can work this.
Thank you.
congregation have the wonderful and beautiful honor of bearing witness as Pastor Fred and Leslie make promises to one another, promises that they gave each other before on their wedding day, and that are made possible by the love of God. Let us pray. Gracious God, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to reveal your love to all people. Enrich Fred and Leslie with every good gift, that their life together may show forth your love, and grant that at last we may all celebrate with Christ the marriage feast that has no end. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Pastor Fred, repeat after me. I take you, Leslie, to be my wife.
Be my wife.
From this day forward. To join with you. Share all that is to come. And I promise to be faithful to you. As long as we both shall live. Leslie, repeat after me. I take you, Fred, to be my husband. From this day forward. To join with you. And share all that is to come. And I promise to be faithful to you. As long as we both shall live. Fred and Leslie, by the promises before God and in the presence of this assembly, continue to join themselves to one another as husband and wife. Those whom God has joined together, let no one separate. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
after supper he took the cup. And he gave thanks and gave it to all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, and it is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this always in remembrance of me. Remembering therefore his death, the resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. And now pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord. Unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now and forever.
Amen.
Otherwise, I'd be able to come with that.